Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God. It says in verse 9 there, and when those beasts give glory and honor and thanks, there is a heavenly bunch of creatures there that they recognized who he was, what he represented, and they couldn't help themselves but say, holy, holy, holy. And having done that, it says that they give glory and honor and thanks. God is worthy. He is worthy of all the glory that we can muster. Glory is admiration. Glory means praise. And glory gives God credit for who he is, and not only for who he is, but all of the things that he does and will do. As an expression of heartfelt gratitude, the Bible is fairly lean on such glorying, particularly as worded, glory to God. Now, a lot of people might say that in this world, but in the Bible, very few ever said glory to God. And yet, the Bible tells us that he's worthy. I know one group that said it in Luke chapter 2 in verse 13 and 14. Suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. The folks that are over there, they glorify God, just like we saw here in Revelation chapter number 4. In Romans chapter 4, in verse 19 to 21, speaking of Abraham, the Bible said, and being not weak in faith, that's talking about him, he considered not his own body now dead when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to perform. It's a wonderful thing for even when something appears to be impossible. Hey, with men, Jesus said, it's impossible. He said, but with God, all things are possible. And Abraham, even at 100 years old, God said, you're going to have a son. There is going to be a seed that's going to flow from you. And he said, I don't know how it's going to happen. I don't feel up to it, but whatever. If you say it's going to happen, it's going to happen. It says there that he did not stagger at the promise of God. It was like, okay. Well, I'll tell you, we could learn so much. Because that would seem to be, from our vantage point, a virtual impossibility, wouldn't it? And yet, how many other things have we read in the Word of God that God has promised, and we thought, no, that's not going to happen. How about, my God shall supply all your need? I go, yeah, right, yeah. And we know all things work together for good. To them, like, yeah, yeah, okay. We rejoice in tribulation. Yeah, 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 yeah. And yet, here's a man that's well past his prime, and God says, you're going to, he said, all right, I believe God. I believe God. Tell you someone else that did it too, in Luke 17. In Luke 17 and verse 15 to 18, one of them, one of whom, a leper. Now we're talking about our crowd, right? One of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back and with a loud voice glorified God, fell down on his face at his feet, Jesus' feet there, giving him thanks, and he was a Samaritan. Wasn't even a full-blooded Jew. And Jesus answering said, were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9? There are not found that return to give glory to God save this stranger. Yeah. That's the extent. You can look it up for yourself. Search the scriptures. You'll find that glory to God only appears in those 3 passages right there. It was done by a heavenly group. It was done by a low-down leper. and it was done to Father Abraham. Back in 1968, on Christmas Day, there were three astronauts aboard Apollo 8. They circled the dark side of the moon and headed for home. Suddenly, over the horizon of the moon rose the blue and white Earth, garlanded by the glistening light of the sun against the black void of space. Those sophisticated, trained in science and technology, did not utter Einstein's name. They did not even go to the poets or the lyricists or the dramatists. Only one thing could capture their awe-inspiring thrill of this magnificent observation. Billions heard the voice from outer space as the astronaut read it. In the beginning, God. The only concept worthy enough to describe that unbelievable awe, unutterable in any other way, in the beginning, God created. I've never had that vision. I've seen some pictures of it and all, but can you imagine just coming around the dark side of the moon and looking back at Earth and realizing that's my home? And it just didn't happen. God made that. Psalm 19 and verse 1 says, the heavens declare what? The glory of God. Now, why should we do that? Well, number one, we should do it because God commanded it. In 1 Chronicles 16 and verse 28, the Bible said, give unto the Lord, ye kindreds of the people, give unto the Lord glory and strength. God said, do it. So we do it. Why? But it's due him. Not just because it's commanded, but it's due him. Psalm 29 and verse 2 said, give unto the Lord the glory due unto his name. Just like we read in Revelation chapter 4, he's worthy. He's worthy. Not to mention the fact that he owns us, which a lot of people fail to realize or fail to at least acknowledge. But in 1 Corinthians 6 and verse number 2, the Bible said, for ye are bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. So everything we do in this shell that we're in is supposed to glorify God. Question is, does it? And then, give you one more. He deserves it. He deserves it. We read again in Revelation 4:11, thou art worthy. He's worthy not only because of who he is, but because of what he's done. In Psalm 86 and verse 13, the Bible said, for great is thy mercy toward me, and thou hast delivered my soul from the lowest hell. And so that's good enough for me. It sure is. The song says, give him the glory for what he's done in your heart. And I think we all should immediately say amen to that. And so, give him the glory. Yeah, we give him the glory because he commanded it. It's due him. He owns us and he deserves it. When should we do it? Well, we ought to do it all the time. All the time. Psalm, again, 86 and verse 12 said, I will praise thee, O Lord my God, with all my heart. I will glorify thy name forevermore. Forevermore. In other words, just like we heard here about these creatures in heaven, they're glorifying God. John saw them 2,000 years ago. They're still doing it. And when we get there, we'll join in. We'll join in that band. Psalm 104 and verse 31 says, the glory of the Lord shall endure forever. Forever. Sometimes we... in this life, we get accustomed to certain things and it becomes old hat. Especially when you live in the particular area. I've had many people say to me over the years, oh, you must go to the ocean all the time. Well, no. Why? Because we live near the ocean. But if you live out in the Midwest somewhere, you may never even seen an ocean. So they assume that we, or if you live up in the mountains, I've asked people, oh, the mountains are so beautiful. You must love going to the mountains. They go, oh, I don't know, are they out there? We grow accustomed to it. hopefully we will never grow that familiar, that accustomed to God, that we're not ready and willing and able to praise Him. But how do we do it? How can we, since we know that we should, we know that some people are doing it, how can we glorify God? Write Him a letter? I'll give you some reasons how we can do it. Number one, by simply, and I've seen this already, stated it because Abraham did it, just believe His promises. Just believe Him. It says in Romans 4, in verse 20 and 21, He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief. We glorify God by believing what He said. Even when we can't fully understand, oh, how's that going to happen? He said, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God. And being fully persuaded that he had what he had promised, he was able also to perform. It's not up to us to figure out how he's going to do it. It's just up to us to believe that he will do it. And all the things that he's done already, that's been accomplished, is really a basis for all future promises that he's ever made. And the mere fact that it hasn't come to pass as yet, I suspect that it probably will. The second thing that we can do, not only simply believing His promises, but fear Him. Fear Him. We're living in a day and age today where people don't believe that that's right. You shouldn't fear God. I understand completely that the world doesn't fear God, and much of modern Christianity doesn't fear God, but the Bible says we ought to fear God, and God said we ought to fear God, and so if we have any sense, we'll do it. Because what it will do is it will curb our behavior. It'll make us realize, like I said this morning about something, He could squash us like a bug if He wanted to. Thankfully, He doesn't. We've got other gods out there that'll do that. Allah will kill you. You know, if you don't serve Him, if you don't kill the infidel, then He'll get you. But not the God of heaven. Revelation 14 and verse number 7 says, saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to Him. So when we fear God, it glorifies Him. Because, and I'm not downplaying God or His position or anything like that, but do you remember the Wizard of Oz? Every now and then I'll bring it up. But when they went in to see the wizard, and all of a sudden he came, because they didn't realize that he was behind a curtain, that it was all a sham. But when all of a sudden his whole image was up there, and it was frightening, and they were all trembling, and they were fearing like there was no tomorrow, until they found out he was a hoax. But notice that they were willing. I mean, he told them, you go and get the wicked witch's broom. Now, who in the right mind? You ever see those all those little creatures there? Oreo. They had to get in there and get her. Oh, I'm melting. They had to do all of that stuff in order to get that broom. And yet, they were more than willing to do it, because that frightening wizard said, silence! We would do well. Now, I know people will probably complain about this, but there's something to be said about fearing God. There really is. This was taken from the journals of missionary martyr Jim Elliot. I don't know if you've ever heard of him, but he was a missionary to the Auca Indians in Ecuador. In reading the scriptures, he said this, I find a great moral power. Therein am I made aware of two great forces for good in human experience, the fear of God and the grace of God. Without the fear of God, I should not stop at doing evil. The fear of God restrains from evil. Without the grace of God, I should have no desire to approach positive goodness. The one is a deterrent from evil, the other an encouragement to good. He also wrote this, "He is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose." How do we glorify God? Believe his promise. Fear him. Praise him. Praise him. Genuinely praise him. Psalm 50 and verse 23 says, "Whoso offereth praise glorifieth me." When was the last time we praised God? Not in a song. I mean, you can do it in a song, but the mere fact that we sing a song that mentions praising God doesn't mean that you were praising God. You might have been under your breath cursing God. You may have been totally out to lunch and were just moving your mouth. The mere fact that we go through the motions isn't genuine praise. Peter Buehler, who helped lead John and Charles Wesley to salvation, once said this, "If I had 1,000 tongues, I'd praise Christ with them all." To which Charles Wesley said, "Ooh, that's good. I'm going to write that down." And what did he write? The well-known hymn, "Oh, for 1,000 tongues to sing." And so praise him. Praise him. It doesn't have to be. As a matter of fact, you're probably better off when you begin to add all the flowery speech, you're probably making it more phony. Just simple, direct. Tell you another way, and this is going to sound strange, but another way that we can praise him is by asking for his help. Asking for his help. Psalm 50 and verse 15 says, "And call upon me in the day of trouble, and I will deliver thee, and thou shalt glorify me." Have you ever noticed in life that when someone asks you for your help, kind of makes you feel good? I mean, they could have asked anybody. Maybe you're the last ditch effort. But generally speaking, say, "I asked you because I know that you know you could do this, or you've done this for somebody else in the past, or whatever. I just had some confidence in you." That's the way God is. When we ask God, when we go to him, not as a last resort, but as the first order of business, well, it says here, "Thou shalt glorify me." Ask for his help. Another way is tell others about Christ. Tell others about Christ. Philippians 2:11 says that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. John 15:8 tells us, "Herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit, so shall ye be my disciples." As we bear fruit, and it doesn't have to be necessarily telling others about just bearing fruit in our Christian lives, by development, by showing forth the fruit of the Spirit. In doing those things, by abiding in him, we glorify God. I got several here, so let me hurry. By our good works. Of course, we're saved under good works, right? Ephesians 2:10. But he says in Matthew 5:16, "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven." Sometimes I think we read these things and those portions of the verses or the passages kind of just like, oh yeah, and that too. But we fail to recognize that these are the elements of us in our frail conditions bringing glory to God. And the Bible says clearly, our text declares it, "Thou art worthy." He's worthy of it. How about suffering? How about suffering for his sake? First Peter 4:14. If ye be reproached for the name of Christ, happy are ye. For the Spirit of glory and of God resteth upon you. On their part he's evil spoken of, but on your part he's glorified. Down in verse 16 he said, yet if any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on this behalf. I guess it probably has something to do with, you know, when we go through those times, we do, as the writer in Hebrews said, consider him. Consider him. Do you think what he did brought glory to God for us? Yeah, it sure did. William Carey, often called the father of modern missions, faced a ministry disappointment of overwhelming proportions. Carey began his missionary career in India in 1793. He labored in that country for 40 continuous years, never once returning to his native England. Carey was an extraordinary translator, translating portions of scripture into over a dozen Indian languages. One afternoon, after 20 years of plodding labor in that country, a fire raged through his printing plant and warehouse. All of his printing equipment was destroyed, but most tragically, many of his precious manuscripts were completely consumed by the fire. Of course, Carey had no computer backup files or photocopies. 20 years of nonstop labor were gone within a few hours. Boy, I'll tell you, do you think that glory, you're either going to say, Lord, I did it for you, or you're going to become angry and resentful toward God. If you did it for God, then you can let it go. If you were doing it for you, and a pat on the back and all that, this would probably put you out of the ministry. How would he respond to that? He wrote to a pastor friend, Andrew Murray, in England, and he said this, the ground must be labored over again, but we are not discouraged. We have not been supported under the affliction and preserved from discouragement. To me, the consideration of the divine sovereignty and wisdom has been very supporting. I endeavored to improve this, our affliction, last Lord's Day, from Psalm 46 and verse 10. Be still now and know that I am God. He said, I principally dwelt upon two ideas. God has a right to dispose of us as he pleases. And secondly, we ought to agree in all that God does with us whatever he chooses to do. Paul said it like this, and that's all he's doing, I think, is pretty much repeating, parroting what Paul said in 2 Corinthians 4, in verse 8 to 12. He said, we're troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We're perplexed, he said, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. Always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. For we which live are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh. So then death worketh in us, but life in you. Let me give you a couple more, because I know you all want to go out of here this week and glorify God. How about just simply coming to the church? Now, I understand I'm going to give you a verse here. In Ephesians 3:21, it says, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Amen. Chances are the passage here has more to do with the universal church. Getting saved and being in the body of Christ. However, in this local assembly, which God also has ordained that we be a part of, I think we can bring glory to Jesus Christ here as well. We're either going to bring glory or shame to him. A study once disclosed that if both mom and dad attend church regularly, 72% of their children will remain faithful in attendance. If only dad attends regularly, 55% remain faithful. If only mom attends regularly, 15% remain faithful. If neither attend regularly, only 6% remain faithful. Moreover, it's required in stewards that a man be found faithful. There's something to be said about just simply being faithful. Faithful to all things in life. And let me give you another one here. How about everything that we do? If we're doing it for our own self-gratification and glorification, then I suspect, like Jesus said, you have your reward. But if everything you do is to the glory of God, like Paul said in 1 Corinthians 10:31, whether therefore you eat or you drink or whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God. And so I believe that it can be done. You can sweep a floor to the glory of God. You can sing a song to the glory of God. You can dig a ditch to the glory of God. You can do everything in this life and bring glory and honor to him. And then, of course, I think this is probably one of the most important. How about just getting saved? Because think about it. What Jesus Christ came into this world to do, not only is it effectual, but it also is universal. Anybody and everybody that comes God's way can get saved. It's mankind basically saying, thank you, Jesus. In Romans 15:7, the Bible said, wherefore receive ye one another as Christ also received us to the glory of God. To the glory of God. When he received us, it glorified God. Even though it seems as though it's an overwhelming task on our part to somehow glorify God. Little us. How am I going to do something like that? Well, we've looked at several things tonight that we can, in fact, bring glory and honor to him. Why? Thou art worthy, O Lord.
You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast, an outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone, Massachusetts. We are an independent, King James Bible-believing Baptist church. Our goal is to reach people with the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, our Lord. You are invited to attend any of our Bible-centered services. Our service times are as follows. Sunday school for all ages at 9:30 a.m. Sunday worship services at 10:30 a.m. and again at 6 p.m. and our midweek prayer meeting and Bible study, Wednesday at 7 p.m. You may write to Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church at 214 Main Street, Blackstone, Massachusetts, or call us at area code 508-883-5302. For additional information about our church, please visit our website at solidrockbbc, all one word, .com.